Hey guys, so today we'll talk about the Cobb-Douglas production function, something that two economists came up with in the 30s and 40s and is still used to estimate production of firms and economies to this day. So what is it all about? Let's take a look at the basics. So the function is made up of five components, as you can see here, but only two are called variables or inputs because the other three that aren't K or L are usually just numbers that we know ahead of time. So what is each one of them? A is productivity, and it's really just a number above zero that we multiply the other components by. And it represents how productive a firm is, or how well it handles the circumstances to produce its output. K is for capital, and the big question that always is, why is K for capital? And the answer is, no one knows, it's a mystery. L is labor, and it's pretty self-explanatory, it's the people that you hire. Alpha is the capital share. So it's what proportion or what percentage of your inputs are capital, such as supplies if you're a factory, or fields if you're a farmer, and just things like that. And B is the labor share, or what percentage of your inputs, of your two inputs, is labor. So that's the basics. Let's go on to the next thing. Another important thing is something called returns to scale. And it pretty much means that if we double both our inputs, do we double the output? Is the output doubled? So in other words, CRS is the big one. It's called constant returns to scale right here. So it means that it's proportional. So if we multiply each input by some number, in our case Z, and it can be any number, doesn't matter, as long as it's above zero. If we multiply the inputs by this Z, is it the same as multiplying the output by Z? So if we do double the fields and we double our workers, will we double the crop supply? So let's see the derivation. Here it is. We just plug in Z to our variables, to our K and alpha, to our K and L. We do the mathematical operations, and we're left with this. So this part and this part are the same. We just have Z to the power of alpha plus beta here, and Z to the power of 1 here. So that must mean for constant returns to scale, alpha plus beta must equal 1. And that's the case where if we double everything, or if we quadruple everything, doesn't matter, then the outcome will also be doubled or quadrupled. But there's two other cases. When alpha plus beta is less than 1, and when alpha plus beta is more than 1. The first one is called decreasing returns to scale, and the second one is called increasing returns to scale. What does this mean intuitively? So for the first one, I like the example of a coal mine. If all of a sudden they decide to double their workers and double their amount of production supplies, like little carts and hammers and everything, will they double the amount of coal? Probably not, because there's no way they're going to fit twice as many people in the coal mines. So they're really not going to have the same output as they if they increase the input. And the same thing with when increasing returns to scale. A good example for this is an IT company. So if it's a small IT company and they only have two workers, two developers, and they double the developers, for example, they hire a product owner and a salesperson, then they're going to do much better because they're all of a sudden going to be able to be more competitive in their field. So those are the two examples I like. Let's go on to the next thing, something called marginal product. Here, let's assume that we have constant returns to scale, so alpha plus beta equals 1, therefore beta is 1 minus alpha, and then we can rewrite the whole function like this, where y equals a times a times k to the alpha times l to the 1 minus alpha. And what are the marginal products? There's two of them, marginal product of capital and marginal product of labor. And it pretty much means that if we increase the input by 1 unit, how much will we increase the output? And it's defined as the partial derivative with respect to capital and labor. And after the derivation, we have our two marginal products here. Note that in each one, capital and labor is in the denominator, which means that this is a decreasing function. What does that mean intuitively? Let's take a look. So if we have our graph, we draw it from the side. It doesn't matter which axis we use for the horizontal, K or L, because they'll look the same. Note that Y is increasing but concave, but marginal product is very decreasing. What does this mean intuitively? So if we just have a restaurant and we opened it up but we don't have any waiters, each additional waiter in the beginning that we add will make a huge difference. As you can see here in the beginning, marginal product is very high. But if now we have something like 50 waiters working in this one small restaurant, hiring the 51st waiter is not really going to do you any good. They'll just be standing around and not working. So another way to look at this, this is the same graph actually in the beginning as this big one. But if we just do this little illustration here. So if you're a guy and you're looking at this 3D graph just from the side of labor, you'll see this. You'll see the concave function of y, because the whole function is 3D and it's kind of concave and decreasing. So that's what you'll see. And that's exactly what will be visible if you're this guy standing looking at the capital axis. You'll also just see this concave 2D figure. Pretty simple, actually. So now that you know all this, you're ready for your first lecture in macroeconomics.
Hope you guys like this video. Make your geek happy. Subscribe to our channel.